Okay, welcome to this fourth part of the lecture. And after our small excursion on Hilbert spaces, let's return to Banach spaces. And I want to give you some more examples for integral operators that we'll be using throughout the lecture. Okay, so one of these will be the convolution operator, which I already mentioned. So this is definition 2.6. We usually look at it in the following sense, that f and g in L1 of Rn, and then we define the convolution of f and g in the following way: f star g of x for an x in Rn is defined as the integral over f of x minus y g of y dy, and as I said, x is in Rn as well. So the convolution is an operator that maps Rn to R, and I state that it's actually, it's well defined. Well, maybe I should have a lemma for that. F star j is well defined and we have that f star j is in L1 of Rn. Let me show the second part. If it's well defined, then the one norm would be defined as the integral over Rn, absolute value of integral over Rn, f of x minus y, g of y, dy, dx, which is smaller than integral Rn, absolute value of f of x minus y, absolute value of g of y, dy, dx. And now I change the order of integration, and I will mention why I can do that later. So this is integral over n, integral over Rn. So instead of dy dx, I write dx dy. So that now becomes f of x minus y dx g of y dy. And of course, the inner one over here is, whoops, makes a transformation x minus y to z, and then this is nothing but the one norm of f. So this is smaller or equal to the one norm of f, or equal to actually one norm of f times, well, the integral, oh, I forgot the absolute value up here, times, well, integral over n, absolute value of g of y dy, so that's norm g, and we have this. Okay, so why is interchanging the integral permitted? Well, for this one, oops, this one is absolutely convergent, so I can change the order of integration here. Okay, and of course, if that is limited, then this integral over here must exist, and then also prove that it's well defined for all, most all x in Rn. Okay, so we have that, and I mentioned that I could now fix g. Oops, that always happens. I can now fix g and view f as a parameter, then the convolution. Maps from L1 of Rn to L1 of Rn. Of course, G in L1, right? And that always happens too. Okay. And now then we have that the norm of f convolved with g, the one norm, is less or equal to the norm of, let me write it this way, norm of g times the norm of f. And since g is fixed, this first one is a constant, and with respect to f, the convolution is continuous. With respect to L1. We'll also show something else for L2 later. I don't need it now. Okay, one thing that's very closely connected to the radon transform, which may be a little bit surprising, is the Hilbert transform. And I'd like to at least introduce it now. Definition 2.7. Oh, no, 2.8 now. The Hilbert transform, let me assume, I won't need anything else than that. So let f in s. So it's a fast decaying function in C infinity. Actually, all we need, I think, is something like C0 intersection with L1 or L2. But anyway. Define the Hilbert transform of a function f at some point x as 1 over pi the integral over r f of y over x minus y dy. Now, that doesn't really make sense, right? I mean, if f is continuous, then this has a pole of order 1 at x, so you can't integrate over it, but you can integrate over it using the Cauchy principal value, which is defined as the limiting value for epsilon to 0, integral over absolute value of y larger than x minus, y minus x larger than epsilon f of y over x minus y dy. And it turns out that this one exists, and it has a very nice correlation with the Fourier transform, and that's something you will show in the next exercise sheet. And also, what follows from its representation with Fourier transform is that the inverse exists. And you can easily show that the inverse is continuous with respect to L2, I think. That's the easiest thing to show. So invertible and the inverse is continuous. With respect to the 2 norm. And that's something you will show in the exercises. Now, next thing, I already mentioned, I just mentioned the Fourier transform. I'm not going to correctly define it here because I will have an extra chapter on the Fourier transform. But now let me not even give it a number. I will just mention it as a remark. You should know the Fourier transform from the lecture analysis 3. And let's take a function f in L1 or L2. I'm not specifying that here. Then the Fourier transform of a function is defined as 1 over 2 pi to the minus n over 2 integral over Rn e to the minus ix psi f of x dx. Now, this is the definition I will always use. This is different from what the engineers usually use in two ways. First, this is my scaling factor, and you will see why I use it in a second. And the second thing that's different is there's a minus sign up here. So usually the mathematical definition of the Fourier transform includes the minus sign. Very often in technical applications, there's a plus sign up there. So whenever you look at technical papers, engineering papers, be aware what the sign is, because that can be crucial. Okay, the inverse transform, and that's something we'll show, is defined as 1 over 2 pi minus n over 2. E to the ix psi f of psi d psi. And with that definition, we have that f hat tilde is f for f in L2. And we'll show everything about this again, and you should know it from analysis 3, but often it's not treated in very much detail. So we look at it again. And now you see why I had this strange factor over here, because now it's the same factor for the forward and inverse Fourier transform. And if you define it differently, like none over here, then if you leave it out in the definition of the Fourier transform, then you get the 1 over 2 pi to the n for the inverse transform. But the nice thing here is both have exactly the same shape, except for the minus sign in the exponent. Okay, we have also something you prove is that the norm of f, the 2 norm of f, is the same as the 2 norm of f hat. And of course, the 2 norm of f is, and of course, that's the same as the 2 norm of f tilde, and again that's due to the factor I introduced. And that means with respect to the 2 norm, and that's, I think that's Plancherel, and that means that the Fourier transform is continuous. Right, its norm is 1. But also the inverse Fourier transform is continuous. It also has a norm 1. So, like for the Hilbert equation, or Hilbert, the Hilbert transform, let me say that this is the Hilbert transform. The inverse of the Hilbert transform exists in a certain space, and it's continuous, so it's a well-posed problem in a way. And also here for L2, we have that Fourier transform and inverse Fourier transform are continuous, so and they exist on all of L2. So also this one is well-posed with respect to L2. Now, one last remark. And I'm showing this here because we'll very often be dealing with improperly posed problems that are discontinuous. In fact, many integral operators are continuous, and that's why I'm giving you some examples, some counterexamples here at this point. Because you always have to be very cautious with these things. Okay, so let's take any operator, or linear operator, from X to Y. Let's assume both are Banach spaces, and let's assume that this operator is linear. Let's further assume that this operator is continuous, its norm is bounded, and in fact we assume that the norm of this operator, and I'm writing as an operator from x to y, is limited by 1, it's smaller than 1. Now then define the operator A as the identity operator minus k. And, well, first of all, you see, of course, the operator norm is limited, so A is continuous. And I say that A is invertible, and this can be done in a very, very general setting, but I will do it very concretely here. And if you've been to, for example, my lecture in numerical linear algebra, then you also, then you already know the trick that's coming up now. We use the Neumann series to compute the inverse explicitly. And so to solve AF equals G, so task is now to solve AF equals G, so find an F such that AF is G. We look at the, we define F as the sum, okay, from 0 to infinity, k to the k, k to the k, well, it's okay, G. Now the question is, does this exist? Does that series exist? And let me just notice that this is bounded. Sum of, well, let me take it up to some finite m. This is bounded by some k to the k, norm k times norm g, and of course this is bounded by the geometric series, so this is smaller than 1 over 1 minus norm of k. And from this it already, it immediately follows that the partial sums are Cauchy sequence So since this is a Banach space, it must converge. So that means that F is well defined. Now, okay, now F is well defined. Now look at what, let's look at what the value is. We have that AF, or A, AF is 1 minus K times the limiting value of K to infinity, K to the K times, write down the definition which I gave, and tending to infinity, sum K equals from 0 to N, K to the K times G. And since everything is continuous, we can take the limiting value out. So that's the limiting value of N going to infinity. Now we have something like, let me just write it down, I minus K times the sum K from 0 to N, K to the K times G. Now this is nothing. I mean, you're adding, subtracting. So this is nothing but G minus K to the N plus 1 times G. Now K to the N plus 1 times G converges to 0 since the norm of K is smaller than 1. So this is G. So we found the inverse. So the operator is invertible. The operator A is invertible. And we have that the norm of A to the minus 1 G, which is the norm of F I defined above, is smaller than, I already had it here, 1 over 1 minus the norm of K times the norm of G. So A to the minus 1 is continuous. And again, the problem AF equals G is a well-posed problem. And of course, this is something you definitely know about if you've been to the lecture on functional analysis. Lost my mouse pointer.